Hello and welcome to Business India with me, Tarun. If you own a mobile phone or anybody who you know owns a mobile phone, then what we are telling you today is very serious. You must hold the cell phone away from your body to the extent that is possible. Use a headset, wired or Bluetooth, to keep the handset away from your head. Do not press the phone handset against your head. Radio frequency energy is inversely proportional to the square of the distance from the source. Also, limit the length of the mobile calls. This is what the Government of India's Department of Telecom has issued as a precautionary guideline. The guidelines further state that the use of text as compared to voice calls wherever possible is advised. If the radio signal is weak, a mobile phone will increase its transmission power. Find a strong signal area and avoid movement. Use your phone where reception is good. Let the call connect before putting the handset on your ear or start speaking and listening. A mobile phone first makes communication at higher power and then reduces to power which is at an adequate level. So, while the phone is connecting, you can hold the phone, mobile phone, away from your head, and when it connects, you can put it to your ear. More power is radiated during call connecting time, and that is why it is important. If you have a choice, use a landline or wired phone, not a mobile phone. People have active medical implants. People, those who have such medical implants, like many people have heart implants, valves, etc., should preferably keep the cell phone at least 15 centimeters away from their implant, from wherever their implant is situated in the body. This is a very important advisory. While purchasing a mobile handset, check the SAR value of the mobile phone. It can be searched on the internet easily if the model number and the make of the mobile phone that you're buying is known. Now, since this advice is given by the Government of India's Department of Telecom themselves, let's discuss this issue one by one with Virag Gupta, cyber law expert and telecom expert, Dr. Mahesh Uppal, Director, Comfirst India. He joins us from Faridabad. Anil Kumar, Secretary, Telecom Watchdog, and Rajan Matthews will shortly join us. He is Director General of COAI. I'm going across to Anil Kumar. Since we are continuing this discussion in our second episode, after we discussed these issues, we discussed quite a lot of issues of use of mobile phones in the first episode. I'm going across to the second set of issues that were raised. Mr. Anil, I would like to ask you this question on, you know, use of mobile phones wherever you get full towers and not where you have one or two towers. This is what the government says as a guideline. How serious is this?
It's very serious. The signal, if it is weak in your area, don't use it for a long time, the handsets. Use it for very short time if the signal is weak. Because when signal is weak, it tries to catch more signal from the tower and it radiates more power from the handset. So it higher power radiation from the handset will create more problem for your health. So that is why this kind of guidelines have been issued by DOT. Worldwide also, this is their research people have conducted, and based on that research, they have said that the wherever there is a good signal, there only you should use this handset, otherwise don't use the handset. Don't make calls, don't receive calls from the handset where the signals are very low. Bio Initiative Group, it's 10 countries, there are 29 scientists, even including 10 scientists from US, Russia, Canada, Germany, all they have come out with their research reports. Consistently since 2007, they have given report that there is an issue with regard to RF radiation on the health. So health is, they are saying that this RF radiation is creating problem.
Very important point made by Mr. Anil Kumar. We'll come back to you. I'm going across to Dr. Mahesh Uppal, Director, Comfirst India. Dr. Uppal, I would request you to tell us that if the DOT issues guidelines requesting people to use phones in an area where they get full towers or at least maximum number of towers that show on their mobile phone, how seriously this should be taken? Because if it was not serious, it would not have been a guideline in the first place.
Look, the issue is the following, that whether it is our government or any other regulatory body, it would like to reduce the exposure to radiation. Okay? Now, the radiation exposure rises if your phone has low level of signal. In other words, you have one or two bars on your phone rather than the four or five that you should. Now, if that is the case, then it radiates more power. More power means more radiation, which is not good for you. And the all the regulations are saying don't do that. However, what we have to bear in mind is that this is all relative. The point is, will you get, because you have low signal on your phone, will the additional power that you will get, will that harm you? For that, the evidence is very limited and the research is very limited. All the major international bodies, not the occasional group of scientists, and I think there are a couple where there are some concerns, but all reputable bodies, whether it is the World Health Organization, whether it is the International Center on Cancer Research, and so on and so forth, all major internationally reputable bodies have actually to date said that the mobile radiation is safe. And as I mentioned in my previous intervention also, just because it is safe doesn't mean that you should keep exposing yourself.
That's an important point, Dr. Uppal. I'll come back to you.
Safe for you if you use them properly, but
basically,
doesn't mean
Dr. Uppal advises to use responsibly. I believe that's what you're saying, that one has to be responsible with what one is using. I'm going across to Virag Gupta for his input on this issue.
Tarun, I have already explained that there are four aspects: guidelines, disclosure, monitoring, and action. Now, here comes the individual consumer who is helpless, then the mobile companies and the tower companies and the government. The biggest question is, there are not sufficient disclosures. And what I was discussing with Mr. Matthews also, that notice has been issued by the Supreme Court in October 2016, wherein very pertinent questions are raised, not only about the parliamentary committee report, but also CAG has observed that minimum 10% check has not been done by the relevant agencies. Now, in the website, web portal is there, but necessary disclosures are not made. In the Jio case, we have seen that what is the magnitude of the call drop. Now, the call drop means weak tower signals, and how it is impacting the general public. Now, there is no scientific study of the same because it is not being accepted. Necessary disclosures are not made. Mobile companies have failed to perform their obligation as engaged in their telecom
license.
I
take your point, but I would like to interject the Jio issue. As I understand, the Jio issue was with regards to the interconnection points that were not being given. It was not the tower issue as we were given to understand.
No, but TRAI has observed that. TRAI has observed and admitted that large amount of the call drop.
Okay, that is a fact. Call drops are a fact. They have happened. Everybody knows about it. Parliamentary committees have talked about it. We'll discuss that issue on some another topic or another discussion. Coming back to focusing on the issue of mobiles.
No, what I'm telling, that call drop are also impacting the radiation.
Okay, that's what you're saying. Okay, I got your point. Call drops impacting radiation. Good. I'm going across to Anil Kumar, of Telecom Watchdog. Mr. Kumar, I'm going on to a next point, that mobile should be kept away from people who've got active implants in their bodies. Now, this, given the fact that mobile use is a fact of life, we have to use mobiles, we can't do without them. How should this advisory be seen? Because if we look in our families, there are many families which have people having heart disease. I mean, heart disease is a fact of life. How do you see this advisory?
This is important to follow this guidelines for the people who have implants.
Yeah, because the life of such implants is 15 years, 20 years. It may shorten, whatever. I don't know.
No, it creates wrong, sends wrong signals.
Yes.
So if it starts sending wrong signals, the heart will beat at different pace.
Okay.
So this kind of problems
you
can
mean
be
the pacemaker and the wall?
Yes, pacemakers can be, it can operate at different levels. So this kind of issues should be taken very seriously. The people who have this implant, so they should try to use as far as possible the landline phones. They should not get it disconnected.
But one advisory says that use landline wherever possible.
Yes, so even bio initiative groups, which the other gentleman, Mr. Upal, has said that it's just some committee or some, they have been consistently doing this research for the last 6-7 years, and they have pointed out that WHO is not considering certain aspects of their concerns. They are focusing only on some part. They are ignoring some other parts. So it's very important for the people who are using this implants. They should be careful that this kind of phenomena is there. Even a small fraction of one, there are million of cells in one particular gram of human tissue, and even if one gets damaged, the cancer phenomena is there.
Okay.
They have pointed out this bioinitiative group in their research reports. Not only in one country, they have given examples of many countries in their reports. Those reports are verifiable, and they are there on their website. Anybody can go bioinitiative working group and find out their health reports for the last three, four issues.
That's an important point. I'm going across to Dr. Upal. Dr. Upal, I would want to understand from you, if DOT has put this out. Now, we all would be knowing in our families or in our friends, people who use, people who have a, what we say, a valve implant or a pacemaker implant or any other implants out of the many medical things that, you know, are implanted these days in our bodies. What seriousness do you see in this advisory? Because this is where it gets serious, because the implants themselves are electrical devices. So how do you see this advisory, and what would be your advice to the people?
See, you're absolutely right. Whatever is pointed out in those guidelines must be taken very, very seriously. If you do have implants, the guidelines or the advice is very clear. Just like when you're going through through checkup on an airport, when you're going through being scanned in, at an airport, they tell you if you have a pacemaker, don't go through that. We all take it seriously. We should. And I think the other thing that is being pointed out about the bioinformatics group, I have all the respect for all scientists. I have been one myself. The real point is, how does anybody evaluate scientific research? You and I and anybody, most people are not competent. They rely on bodies of international credibility, international repute. If they have ignored something, we need to point it out. But what I'm still saying is that just because one group of scientists says X and another one says Y, our only we cannot just say that this is right and that is wrong. Our approach has to be to look for somebody of competence, somebody of credibility to tell us how to read that. And that's what we do. And I think it is very, very worrying that we try to just highlight only that evidence or only that data that somehow supports our prejudice or our own view. Now, that is very unhelpful to most people who have to deal with mobile phones. For all I know, it might be even more serious, but I have nobody has any serious competence to evaluate the quality of research other than their peers, other than people who evaluate these this kinds of research. So that is my limited point.
Okay,
we have to rely on people of credibility, organizations where people will lose jobs if they don't do their job well, etc., etc.
Okay, point taken. I'm going across to Virag Gupta for his take on this issue.
Tarun, India has biggest number of mobile users, even more than the toilets we have the mobile. Now, it's obligation of the government and the mobile companies to create awareness among the general people about the uses of mobile phone. Our large majority is illiterate, and they are not aware about the radiation and other aspect of the mobile uses. So like you started the program by the seat belt in the car, in the same manner, the bigger issues should be with the government, mobile companies and other regulatory bodies. But ordinary customer should be given elementary knowledge of all these precautions by the mobile companies and by the government.
So you are saying a notification is not enough.
There is provision for the web portal.
You are saying an advisory is not enough. It should be well publicized.
Yes. Exactly. Because we have the largest number of mobile users other than any other product. And mobile, when we are importing the mobile handset,
can I come on
then
this?
There has to be some connection between the telecom departments and the DGFT.
I think
Dr.
Uppal wants to give a
so
reply.
That at the port itself.
No. In fact, I do not want to give a reply. Actually, I want to support what Mr. Viraj is saying. I disagreed with many of the earlier points, but this point is absolutely fair. We have every reason to provide the highest quality and the most widespread information as possible. There can be no two ways about it. It is an important subject. People should be given quality information. People should be given information in a form that they can use, in a form that is easily digestible, etc., etc. So there can be no argument against transparency.
No,
there can be no argument against
due caution. Dr. Uppal.
Yeah.
Yes, go on.
Dr. Uppal, there is a provision for the web portal in the para 7 of the office memorandum. Now, in that web portal, sufficient disclosures are to be made by the mobile companies. And in spite of the 2.5 years time period, same is not done. So unless there is disclosure, how can there be monitoring or how can there be assessment of it?
Mr. Gupta, I would want to ask you a question. Like on cigarette packets, there are certain disclosures.
Please.
Do you think that mobile phone boxes should have like 10% or 20% of the area or anything? Or the government should put ads in various newspapers or portals about this? Is that what you're saying?
No, they're both are different things. What I'm saying about you, that government telecom companies should notify about the features of the mobile handset, that what are the necessary parameters which must be there in the mobile phone, those should be notified to the customs authorities and the DGFT, so that it should be ascertained at the port of import. That is the one aspect what we have discussed. Now, the second, once the mobile phone is of the required scientific feature, then how same is to be used? For that, government should not only in the mobile handset packing, but do by different media channels, necessary awareness should be created for the safety of the consumers.
Since you have made this point, Mr. Gupta, before I go to Mr. Anil Kumar, I would request to tell you, if mobiles are imported by the millions in the country, will it prevent people from misdeclaring or declaring it wrongly about the SAR values? Because who's going to check each consignment? Do you think that is possible?
No, that declaration has to be supported by the manufacturer certificate.
Okay. I take your point.
There is provision for the 2% sample check by the customs authority.
I think Anil Kumar wants to come in. Mr. Kumar.
There are so many certified labs. You can, without even showing a handset, you can get the certificate. That is the kind of, not even a single handset has been caught which is having wrong SAR value so far. For the last 2 years since then, this regulation has been imposed. So far, not even a single handset has been detected which is having SAR beyond the permissible limit. So it means there is something, either everything is okay or something is wrong. So certification based import, every import is being done.
But you are making a very important point, Mr. Kumar. I am going across to Dr. Uppal and would like him to respond to that. Dr. Uppal Kumar, Mr. Kumar says that not even one handset was found violating, which means either everything is hunky and dory and good or there is certain violation. Please, Dr. Uppal, make your point and then Mr. Gupta can also come in after you.
Yeah. Well, let me actually start with the point that Mr. Gupta made earlier. Again, I am in agreement with him about the basic point. The point is simply this. He's saying that there is no certification, there is no compliance with those guidelines. It is not my point at all that you should somehow compromise on compliance. If there are rules, they must be adhered to. People who have been asked to make those those disclosures should be asked to, should be compelled to, etc. There is no two ways about this. I don't stand for anybody not following the guidelines that have been issued and not complying with them. Point taken. As far as the second point is concerned, I think the clue to this may well be, and I'm only speculating now, that all major brands of mobile phones have no reason to not comply with these specifications. I think the risk to their brands, to their sales and their reputation is so much greater than the advantage of misspecifying their products. However, I think the real concern to me is anecdotal evidence suggests that there is a large number of cheap handsets, second-hand handsets also, which are being imported in this, not imported, smuggled into this country. And those may well be those which are complying with these things.
Indeed,
they have been made by fly-by-night companies.
What Dr.
So
Uppal
that is where
is
the,
true.
We should be concerned.
It is a serious cause for concern. If what Dr. Uppal says, I mean,
exactly,
we all know it's happening,
I
but
cannot,
we all know what's happening, but how, on what scale it is happening is what we can't fathom at this moment, because new brands of mobile phones are being launched every day. Most of them are imported. Of course, they are not manufactured here. It's very difficult to know where, whether it's refurbished, whether it's new. One cannot ascertain. So, what Dr. Uppal says is indeed of a grave consequence.
No, but let me just...
Yes, please.
Allow me to just correct what you're saying a bit. Yes. I am not saying that new brands are to blame.
Yes.
No. I am saying that the unbranded phones, the phones that get through, which are smuggled, etc., those have no reason to comply because they're in any case illegal. As far as the regular brands are concerned, I may one or dislike the other, but the fact remains that there is no great reason why they should want to misspecify their product, because they have to survive in this market. It's not a good idea for them. And it's not as if it is something that will hurt their sales if they were to understate or overstate their SR values. No. So I am just suggesting that we need to worry about compliance in the sense that we have
compliance.
To stop
okay.
or, and make sure that smuggled
okay.
goods.
I'm going to, I'm going to
that
Mr.
Is
Gupta
the issue.
Very
the
quickly and Mr. Anil Kumar can come in
my
after that.
Opinion,
yes, Mr. Gupta.
May not be the problem.
And then Mr. Anil Kumar.
Tarun, Dr. Uppal, what is saying? He's saying that the branded phone normally don't misdeclare their description.
Yes.
And he's talking about the grey market mobile phones and second-hand mobile phones being imported. Now, as per law, second-hand handsets are normally not allowed, and they are certainly being imported by misdeclarations. So here we need to enforce not only the telecom agencies but the our other agencies, revenue agencies, who can prevent such type of illegal import. But more than that, if there is organized such import of cheap mobile phone which are injurious for the health and which may be responsible for the radiation, so government must take action against such type of cheap handsets.
Okay.
In Delhi,
absolutely.
After this environment crisis,
absolutely.
government has taken action against the old vehicles.
I take your point. I think Anil Kumar wants to come.
15 years old vehicles
moment.
Are
yes,
banned.
Mr. Kumar.
All the handsets which are coming into country, they are, I think, not smuggled. So most of them, almost every handset, is passing through custom channel, because custom duty is how much? Just 5%. Smuggling, the risk is more than paying just 5%. So I don't believe that the handsets are being smuggled and they are the having this SAR value problem. There is no, I think SAR value is almost all the handsets, they are complying to this requirement. That's why not even a single handset has been caught so far. My problem is about the towers. There has to be a warning as per the guidelines. There, like on cigarette use.
No, but Mr. Kumar, I want to ask you a question. Since
yes.
you raised towers, in Defence Colony in Delhi, the whole RW of the colony came together and ensured that no tower is installed in the whole colony itself. They say install towers outside our colony, because each resident said not on my building. In the end, the mobile phone companies were in problem and they had to request, where do we put it? If we put in the garden, you say it's front of my house. If we put it in some other park, you say it's near my house. So in the whole colony, there was no tower. So mobile phone companies say, either we give you service or where do we put the tower? So do you think as awareness increases, now this is a tricky area, isn't it?
No, there are low emitting base stations are also there. Antennas are also there that the operators should use them. It can be put on the streets. You cannot even point out, yes, there is an antenna installed there.
Yes.
There are smart electrical poles which are there in the Western world.
Yes.
Here also it should be installed. We are creating smart cities. Let there be smart poles on the streets where
so
Wi-Fi, antenna, everything should be there. My issue is that this kind of guidelines are there. 2 feet wide and 3 feet height, there should be a warning on each BTS towers, three type of warning, danger, warning, caution. They are saying that don't touch tower. This is a warning 2x3. Where is this? Is nowhere it can be seen
so
on any
warnings
of the
are
towers.
Not being put up and that's a cause of serious concern.
Yes. That is what is the problem. Warning, no ionizing radiation beyond this point. Don't enter non-ionizing radiations.
So you mean no precautionary warning for mobile towers. Indeed, this is an important issue which we'll also take up in the coming episode. But since we are totally out of time on this one, thank you so much, gentlemen, for sparing time and joining us in for today's discussion. Indeed, the use of mobile phones and the DOT giving guidelines raises certain questions and also tells us that we need to be very careful when we, our children, our near and dear ones, people who have medical implants, use these equipments or these electronic devices responsibly. Thank you so much, gentlemen, for joining us on today's discussion of Business India. Thank you.